Well, friends, we have come through this process for more than a year now, and of course I am very thankful to Dr. Ravi Shankar and the AFA for giving me this this kind of a journey. It has been beneficial for me in a different view, like, and also having completed 12 sessions, I think I have enriched myself. That's what I feel. And I think probably this could be the last of these sessions. We can think of that later maybe. Now, with all that, today we are going to discuss about my clinical experience about the common diseases of urinary system and my approach to the clinical management of those. Now, before going into the practical clinical issue, a bit about the theory. Now, I will not go much into the theory, but a brief about the theory part as such. Of course, many times the students would feel like the anatomy and physiology described in Ayurvedic texts is not sufficient enough to deal with the present situation or deal with the clinical conditions. But that's not really so. Rather, the description is quite elaborate and it gives almost the same detail as we know about the current physiology. Only thing is, the description is in the form of sutra, very brief, and many times we need to understand it in the proper perspective. Most of the times in the clinical these classrooms, this kind of the study is neglected. So from that point of view, I would like to give some idea about the basic understanding of the anatomy and physiology described in the Ayurvedic text very briefly as such. Now, among those urinary system as such, of course, urine is considered as mala, mutra is considered as a mala, and the function is to regulate the cladder. Cladder is the fluid and electrolyte balance of the body. And the major organ which is described in the text is basti. Interestingly, the word basti is translated as bladder, and in the current anatomy sense, bladder relates to a organ which is used for collection of the urine only. But basti is the organ where the urine is formed even. Sushruta has given the description of the basti as a structure having only one opening. Nadhi, prastha, kati, mushka, buddha, vankshana, shepasan, ekadvaraha, tanuhu, tvakkaha. So, ekadvaraha, one opening. But whereas now with the correct anatomical idea, we have three openings in the bladder. But the real view of the basti should be in such a way that it's only the structure which is used for collecting the urine as such. So, renal pelvis and the calyces as well as renal pelvis, ureter and the so-called bladder. Of course, both the ureters put together, so would be considered as a basti. So basti is a alabhua ivarupena. So it will have a feature of alabhu, elongated structure. It's not only about the bladder, that's the important. And it's the mutrashaya. So we need to consider basti in an anatomical sense from Ayurvedic point of view, which involves the whole of the collecting system of the urine, whereas the vrukka, the outer portion, would be the urine forming function. So from Ayurvedic point of view, we will be studying those functions of the urine under these heads: the structures which are related to the formation of the urine and the structure which is related to the collection and excretion of the urine. And the same, there is another description about the mutra vaha srotas, the channels which are responsible for the movement of the mutra. That again, often there is a bit of confusion or maybe the interpretation in somewhere the things are different. The interpretation of that mutra vaha srotas, which is considered as two. So many times students have asked me like whether Sushruta had two urethras. No, it's not really the urethra. When Sushruta says the two of the mutra vaha way or the mutra vaha srotas being two, it's about the two aspects of the bladder. That's the one is the proximal portion of the bladder and the ureter where the urine is formed and then remains collected in, that forms the one portion. And the next part is the passage through which it gets evacuated, the urethra. So basti hi moolam, basti would be the moola, and you will have a collecting system in the proximal area, and at the distal portion is the other part, and all that clinical features which are related to the possible complications related to the mutrohosrotas, they can be explained better when you have understood this way. So that's a need to understand the mutrohosrotas in that manner. The description of the anatomy and anatomical relationships of the basti also is in detail, where it's an organ in the pelvic cavity, and it has the relationship with the bastihi, bastishirascheva, polosham, roshanam, budaha. So that description is very much as good as any of the current anatomical descriptions where the anatomical relationships are described. So I will not go into much of the detail of that now from as a theory point of view, but we have to consider that part also, that the description of the anatomy is quite elaborate. And basti also is considered as a sadhya pranaharamarma. So many times the questions are asked like, if it is a bladder, is a sadhya pranaharamarma. We have a situation or many situations where the whole bladder could be removed. Surgically it can be removed and it could be handled. Any time the bladder could be handled safely. You may do any number of surgeries in the bladder too. So whether it is justified or not. Now the issue is, Sushruta's period, if the bladder would be injured, of course, in any form, then there is always a possibility of the contamination of the urine with the peritoneum would be contaminated with the urine, and a peritoneal contamination can be quite dangerous. And even with the present day situation where you have all the facilities of management of such critical conditions, still the prognosis can remain poor, though I don't say that the patient would die instantaneously. A ease of handling of the bladder is related to the historical idea. Only in 1890s, beyond that period, a suprapubic approach to the bladder was possible because of identification of one of the anatomical phenomena, that a distended bladder would have a peritoneal cleavage. It will be lifting of the peritoneum, and hence you can get an access in the suprapubic area into a bladder without the urine getting leaked into the peritoneum. Whereas in an empty bladder, this would not be possible. So the point is, even now when we do in the surgery, like when we handle the bladder in the surgery, like suprapubic approach is done, before we do the incision, the bladder is distended. Purpose of distending the bladder is to get that space where you can get an access to the bladder without reaching to the peritoneum. Now if this fact is not controlled, if this is not really identified, there is always a possibility of the urine leaking into the peritoneum, and a peritoneal leakage and peritoneal irritation would be quite critical. And that's exactly why Sushruta has considered, though it is a sadhya pranaharamarma, if it is handled by a surgeon for the treatment of the ashmari, then there may not be a fatal complication if you handle it once, and given is kriyabhyasat shastra vihitat chedat nisyanda parivrdhatva chashalyasya. Because a surgeon will be making an incision with all the anatomical knowledge, and the incision is already, the process of making the incision is already described in the text. Though of course Sushruta had preferred a perineal approach than a suprapubic approach, the point is the same, like if you can get into the bladder without reaching to the peritoneum or without leaking up the urine into the peritoneum, which even in the Western surgery up to the late 19th century, the same was the access, perineal was the access, suprapubic access came into the picture only in the later part of the history, and that's the real issue which we need to consider. So when Sushruta says about the basti as sadhya pranaharamarma, we have to consider this surgical aspect too. Anyway, that's one part. Now the next part, very brief about, now I am not going much into detail, the very brief is about how the urine is formed. Many times people will say like the description of the physiology of the urine formation in the text is not sufficient or insufficient, or many times it's a joke also, people say like it is compared to, the formation of urine is compared to the water flowing into an earthen pot which is kept upside down. So something like a passive osmosis. But it's not only the passive osmosis which is mentioned in the Sushupta. The direct description is only that much, like aamkhat salivarinya sattvashvabhya pulyate namaha ghataha, like a ghata where it will be, the water will be leaking through. You will get more of the description in terms of when you go into the gana, the dravyas or the medicines which can be used in the management of the mutra. Of course, from the current physiology point of view, in brief, urine formation would be at three stages. The first stage would be in the glomerulus, where a large quantity of the fluid is leaking, actually leaking into the glomerulus, and it's a passive diffusion, where the fluid movement is regulated only by the pore size, and any substance which would have a molecular size bigger than that of the glomerular pore would be retained, whereas other substances will leak. But you will have a huge impact in the proximal loop of Henle, proximal convoluted tubule and the loop of Henle. In these areas, there will be a significant reabsorption as well as a new excretion of the substance. So there is another phase of the reabsorption. And then there is a third phase in the distal convoluted tubule, where a large amount of the water is again reabsorbed, and hence the water is retained. Now these three functions are described in the Gana Sangraha as the Mutra Virechaniya Dravya, Mutra Sangrahaniya Dravya and Virajaniya Dravya. The Virechana word is related to the glomerular functions, where the fluid is really flowing through, and you have a good the set of drugs which would be impacting that portion. So any patient, any conditions where you have a glomerular pathology, the drugs like Jambuamra, Plakshavata, Kapitana, etc., they would be useful, which will be regulating that part. Whereas the area, the mutra virajana, the meaning of word is removing the color. That's about the tubular functions, where the proximal tubular and loop of Henle functions, where the substances either are reabsorbed or re-excreted, so that the content of the urine is properly managed. And in any disease conditions where you have the pathology of that sort, the kashaya gana, padma utpala nalina, etc., madhura dravyas, they are preferred to be used in such categories of the conditions. Whereas the mutra sangrahana, mutra virajaniya, slightly the difference is, the mutra sangrahana, the jambu amra, etc., are the mutra sangrahaniya dravyas, and vrikshadani, shodamustra, etc., which we otherwise consider as diuretics, they are the mutra virechaniya dravyas. So gokshura, etc., they come under the mutra virechaniya dravya. So the important reason, all the three functions, the tubular, glomerular, as well as the proximal convoluted tubular functions, they are described, though they are not described expressly, their functions are described and their clinical utility is described as such. So that's the importance of the physiology of the urine formation according to the Ayurvedic literature. Now that's how the urine is formed. Then the next part is about the excretion of the urine, regulation of the excretion of the urine. That regulation of the excretion of the urine is a very complex process, where this involuntary activity is now converted into a voluntary activity, which is a learning process, and that process is under the control of apanavata, and the apanavata as well as the dhamanis, adhoga dhamanis, are the structures which regulate that function. So when we come into the scope of the management, you will have the group of drugs like mutra virechana, virajana, as well as the sangrahana, which can impact upon the formation of the urine. And then you have the modalities of treating the patients, where the excretory functions and synchronization of activity of the micturition are regulated. Now this kind of a background is necessary to understand the basic needs of the disease conditions. When you go into further into the detail about the diseases, this background information is slightly necessary. Of course, though we say that it is apana vata alone, in the present day situation, we may make out the categories of these abnormalities with the specific initiation like urofluometry or seismogram, so that each minute details of that abnormal functions can be made out more accurately than what the text would say. So the correct technologies would help you to give more detailed approach about that. With this slight background, that physiological background, I will not go further into the detail of that. Let me directly get into the clinical conditions which we meet with in the clinical practice. Now, among those common neurological disorders which we come across, one of the very common conditions which we come across would be a nocturnal enuresis or Shaya Mutra. And very often it is a concern of the parents. And interestingly, in our Brihatrayi, you do not find much of a description about this condition. Whereas in the Shargadhara, you get a very casual reference of that condition as a Shaya Mutra, though there is no detailed pathology described and a specific approach to the management is not really described in the text. Of course, some yogas are mentioned for the Shaya Mutra, but the detailed pathology is not available in the text as such. Now, to understand that Shaya Mutra or that nocturnal enuresis, we need to have some idea about the current approaches as well as try to understand that pathology from the clinical point of view. As I told earlier, micturition is basically an involuntary function. At the time of the birth and in the initial stages, it's essentially involuntary and it's normal. In lower animals too, it's an involuntary process. But the process becomes voluntary later on as the growth occurs, and on an average, by the age of about 4 to 5 years, majority of the children would develop a control over the micturition and it doesn't remain to be voluntary. So when voluntary control is not being beyond the age of 5 years, usually the parents would be having a concern and they come for the consultation or we'll have to give an opinion over that. Rarely the same may persist, that involuntary may persist even up to the adult age, very rarely, and that comes a cause of concern. Though it's not a single disease entity, it has to be considered. A patient presenting with this symptom of the nocturnal enuresis, they need to be considered carefully. Most of the times it doesn't require a specific treatment, but every patient coming to you with the history of a nocturnal enuresis, and when I say nocturnal enuresis, the standard is a child who has not gained the control even after the age of 5 years. That's the usual standard. Of course, at times it can be extended up to 7 years. So, it could be 5 or 7 years if the child has not has a voluntary control. In that condition, certain of the important issues which you need to consider would be, there could be many other underlying accompanying pathologies which may have a severe impact upon the whole course of the health of the child, and hence a detailed study is required before you conclude, like whether it is an innocuous or benign condition or whether there is a need for any energetic treatment. Now, to give some basic clue would be, if the child has the other accompanying clinical symptoms like a weight loss or growth retardation or maybe nausea like symptoms, who is not taking the food properly, then you need to think of many other possible diseases, and among those possible diseases, juvenile diabetes is one of the common conditions. I won't say that every child would be of juvenile diabetes condition, but it has to be considered as such. Or at the same time, if the child complains about a excessive thirst and with a need to drink at night extra some, then it should be juvenile diabetes has to be considered quite significantly as such. So if the child has these set of the symptoms like weight loss and growth retardation and excessive thirst, you need to have a detailed investigation. I can't say exactly like what could be the underlying pathology, though juvenile diabetes could be very common. But at the same time, there could be many other renal disorders which need to be ruled out. So a thorough investigation would be difficult. They are needed, and without that, if you just consider this as a simple symptomatic condition, probably you may miss the bus. Similarly, another of the important symptoms which you have to see is whether the child has a difficulty in passing the urine, a weak stream, or has to stream in more, then there could be an obstructive pathology. You need to investigate about that part, like whether there is any urethral stricture or a bladder neck obstruction. Any of those pathologies they need to be ruled out, which again require a detailed investigation. Protocol of that investigation we will be discussing later when we discuss about the mudra ghata later. If there is if the child has gained the micturitary control in the beginning, at the age of 5 or 7 years, the child has gained the micturitary control. But later, after a certain period of time, again the control is lost and there is a nocturnal enuresis. That would be again a concern, and that's what we call as a secondary nocturnal enuresis. In such conditions, you need to think of two important conditions, general diabetes or urinary tract infections. So urinary tract infections, of course, we will be referring to this issue again when we discuss about the urinary tract infection as such. So an investigation in that direction is necessary. If the child has a sleep apnea like or heavy snoring abnormality of the sleep disorder, then you have to examine the respiratory tract thoroughly. It could be like due to the respiratory tract infections or abnormalities related to the respiratory tract, the child may be having the micturitary abnormality. If the child has an enuresis during the daytime too, it's not only the night and it's in the daytime too, there is a definite structural abnormality like a bladder neck dysfunction, either structural or synchronization abnormality like bladder neck dysfunction. So bladder neck dysfunction again we will be discussing somewhat in detail later when we discuss about the mudra ghata later. Then there is one set of the conditions, functional, behavioral of the abnormalities. Very often it happens like a child may have these nocturnal enuresis at the time of school going age, because of some stress in the school, or maybe in the family if there is another child or younger child born, and then if the child feels like the parent's attention is reverted to that newborn, then too there could be behavioral abnormalities. So that has to be considered. So important is that nocturnal enuresis cannot be considered as a simple casual condition, though in majority of the conditions, the real pathology is insignificant. Many of times, it's not really a disease, it's only something variation in the learning process as such. But a careful assessment is necessary, and the important clues which are required to assess those, I have discussed that in the previous issue. Now, once you have decided about and then ruled out all those significant pathologies like juvenile diabetes, infections, etc., and you have considered this as only a symptomatic pathology as such, then the management, so the important majority of those can be managed without any pharmacological management or any medicinal management too. Certain the habit, developing the habit of going for nutrition just before the bed, and some scheduling that toilet habits as such. Or now there are certain alarm devices which are available, waiting alarm devices, which can be fixed over to the genitals, and hence once the one drop of the urine comes in, the child gets awakened and then gradually it strains the child as such. Or it could be the diapers. These are maybe environmental factors like just warm environment instead of extremely cool conditions. These also can be helpful. Now, if even these do not help, then the need for the pharmacological management comes in. When I prescribe the medicine, so my prescription to be prescription of the medicine to be only after having ruled out all the other pathologies, and only in the absence of the other disease conditions, and if it is a functional disease conditions or somewhat functional or something like indirectly assessed or indirect causes of these conditions, my prescription would be, if it is a bladder neck dysfunction, and if it is a bladder neck dysfunction which is actually an abnormality of the synchronization, one of the apana vata vikriti, where the synchronization of the higher centers and the lower muscles is not proper, set of the muscles is not proper. Again, I am not going into much of the details about that. In that condition, If the residual volume is quite high, more than 100 ml, then definitely that cap needs to be treated surgically. An interventional treatment would be required. If the residual volume of the urine is less than 50 or maybe around 70 ml or less than that, then that can be managed with the Ekambhiradasa and Ashwagandha Gesta. That's how I manage the conditions. If the child has a sleep disorder, like the child is not able to sleep properly, or there is the slight behavioral abnormality, like in that condition, Medhya Vishri, like Saraswara Gesta, as such. Pure functional pathologies, where there is no organic pathology at all, and it could be the stress like a school going age, in that condition Saraswara Gesta could be the prescription. And other two important factors which we see in the clinical practice is a child who has a constipation, during the constipation has tendency to have these nocturnal enuresis. So if you can manage the constipation, that would be enough. And I usually prefer Kumaryasa in such a constipation within the complication of the nocturnal enuresis as a prescription, with an idea of facilitating the functions of the agni as well as the appetite, this acid of the stools too, so that many of those complications can be avoided. Another is worm infestation. Many a time the children with worm infestation, particularly pinworms, due to the irritation in the perianal area, they may have an urge for micturition, and in such conditions my prescription will be Krimikuthara Rasa. So a nocturnal enuresis child has to be thoroughly analyzed, and then we need to plan the management, then the success rate would be higher. That's one of the condition. Next of the condition which is commonly used is a urinary tract infection. Of course, the word urinary tract infection is a very broad term, and in a clinical practice it requires rather something like anthill like. So there is lots of underlying pathology, and the only visible evidence would be urinary tract infection. So every patient of urinary tract infection has to be carefully assessed. From the gross manage, instead of going to the huge detail, I will try to minimize those details and to facilitate that and to have a better clinical approach. We can consider the whole infective pathologies under the pediatric conditions, where there is something specificity about the clinical presentation and the disease management, and there will be some specific causes in the females and males. Then of course the other important is the post-intervention, where some intervention is done, or of course there is an acquired social community acquired infections to hospitalized patients where there is a possibility. These need to be tackled in a different approach. Now, pediatric conditions, one important, in children having the urinary tract infection is though not very common, but is very significant. Important is it is significant, and chances of missing the actual diagnosis will be quite high. And incidence also would be having certain pattern, like it's usually more in the age of, the number incidence is increased by the age of around 4 to 5 years. That's the time where the child gains a control over the micturition. So during that period, the possibility of a urinary infection is more. And then again, at the age of 16 or 17, where the child develops the sexual organs, then too, the incidence tends to be more. These are the two phases where you have a large number of children presenting with the urinary tract infections. In addition to that, the other important is that the clinical presentation of a urinary tract infection in child in pediatric practice could be different from what we see in the adults. In the usual adults, you have a standard set of clinical symptoms like a micturition, abnormalities like burning sensation, fever, etc. And then many times the patient may himself or herself would say that there is something with the urine, either there is some abnormal discharge or so on. But with the children, the clinical presentation could be of different sort, and hence you have to be careful. A child of below 6 months having these set of clinical symptoms like a jaundice, or maybe the most important is failure to thrive, the child is not gaining weight properly, or a vague fever, not a very high fever, the feeding is lesser, frequent vomiting, irritability, the child is having more irritable factor, these could be produced due to many other conditions, and one of the causes could be urinary tract infections. In that condition, though there may not be any direct history related to the urine, you need to investigate, and maybe one of such causes of vague symptoms like failure to thrive, poor feeding, etc., could be the urinary tract infection, particularly significant in the very young age of 0 to 6 months. In the period of 6 months to 2 years, the fever becomes more common, and many times the urine symptoms could be seen. Parents may observe that the urine smell is different, strong smelling urine is common. The child may even complain of abdominal pain, which also have some resemblance to that of the adult clinical symptoms. So, in that condition, and of course, fever may be somewhat more specific, more relatively high. Children at the age of 2 to 6 years, the features could be presenting with the enuresis. That's the important point. Of course, the other symptoms are common, vomiting, abdominal pain, fever. Of course, the fever tends to become more higher. Chills also may be seen in that age. Smell of the urine also may be noted. And enuresis is a common as such. Along with that, the child may be able to complain of symptoms like difficulty, urgency, and increased frequency, etc. Whereas children above the age of 6, incontinence also could be. It's not only the enuresis, incontinence, leakage also could be the clinical symptom. So you need to have a clear idea about the possible clinical symptoms of the urinary tract infections, and some of them could be somewhat misleading. In addition to these, other clinical signs like a tenderness in the cross-vertebral angle at the upper part of the abdomen, or in general a abdominal tenderness, a tenderness in the suprapubic area, or a distended bladder, a poor stream of urine or straining void, these also could be the other clinical symptoms in a child when the child presents with the urinary tract infection. So you need to go for the investigations and identify the patient. So that's the important point. In pediatric practice, identification of the urinary tract infection is one of the critical issues. As far as the management point of view, from my point of view, when we discuss with the analytic management point of view, I don't find any much difference except that the dosage of the drug could be different. Whereas in adults, when again I will try to make it a common for female and the male, for the adults, when we go for the urinary tract infection, a patient presenting with the urinary tract infections, the important point is that there could be many underlying pathologies which can really trigger the urinary tract infections. So it's not that a patient having the infection, diagnosed as infection, should be treated only targeting the infection. There is a need to consider a possible underlying pathology, and which can be quite elaborate exercise. And those could be, one we need to consider the other way, factors which can reduce the excretion or somehow affect the excretion of the urine, tendency for the urine to remain in the urinary system as such. It could be due to an obstruction due to the stone or a tumor or maybe a stricture or prosthetic hypertrophy, etc. So a patient having a repeated urinary tract infection may have an underlying critical severe pathology like even a malignancy possible. So it needs to be identified. Or it could be an obstruction outside the urinary tract, which may be producing a compression upon either the bladder or maybe the ureter or maybe the kidney, where there could be compression of the urinary tract and hence the flow may be obstructed. So you need to go for all the investigations like you either ultrasound or maybe intravenous pyelography required as such. Or any cause of urinary retention like a neurogenic bladder or any abnormalities of the bladder wall as such. Even renal disorders like nephritis also could be the other, or maybe the structural abnormalities of the kidney like horseshoe kidney, congenital abnormalities or polycystic kidney also could be the cause for the urinary tract infection. Presence of the foreign bodies like the stones or catheters, one important, most of the times the common cause for the urinary tract infections are interventions, medical interventions, any sort of the instrumentation, cystoscopy or urodynamic study, or a catheter indwelling or maybe even a temporary intermittent catheterization. could be the cause for the urinary tract infection. The another factors like congenital defects leading to obstruction are the same pathologies, and urinary fistula, either into the vagina or the rectum, also could be the cause for the urinary tract infections. And in the females, one of the specific is a short urethra. Structure right now in the urethra is shorter, and particularly in the sexually active age, such patients, they tend to have repeated urinary tract infection. Obesity also could be one of the precipitating factors. Then the systemic pathologies which can affect the immune response of the body, like old age, it's common. Of course, immunosuppressed disease like conditions, HIV, diabetes mellitus, they too can trigger the urinary tract infections quite frequently. Other secondary factors like constipation, or patients having an abnormal period, the micturitary functions as such, they too can have the urinary tract infections. Pregnancy is another cause which can trigger the urinary tract infections. Sexual activity is one of the common causes, particularly newly married. One of the specific condition which is mentioned in the books is a honeymoon cystitis. Newly married in the initial sexual active phase, it could be. Particularly, this infection could be more critical in persons who have multiple sex partners or simply who are not maintaining the hygiene of the area. In addition to these, another quite significant is community-acquired UTI, urinary tract infections, where the real causes could be simply because the person is in a situation where you have the bacteria which can result in passing, or fecal-urethral transmission. Fecal-urethral transmission is patients having abnormality of the gastrointestinal tract, and then as the patient passes those organisms through the rectum, some of these could be entering into the urinary tract as such. And this constitutes these community-acquired UTI, where the real causes are not really made out. They could be quite significant, and it is estimated that the global burden is around 150 million people. So, large number of people. The exact cause of the urinary tract infection may not be possible to be identified, and that's why most of the times in the clinical practice, you will be just writing the diagnosis like a UTI, and you may not go into the cause. But every time you need to have some effort to understand the real causes, and then only there could be a solution as such. Now, urinary, I will not go into much of the details. The one of the important area where we can, Ayurvedic people can have some advantage would be, because the most of the times the resistance of the organism to the antibiotics is increasing very rapidly, and this is the pattern of the antibiotic and then sensitivity to the urinary tract infecting organism. Common organisms are Escherichia coli and Proteus organisms, and the initial stages, like in a few years back, like 2008 or so earlier, some 10-15 years earlier, you had a good number of drugs. The green color suggests about those drugs which were effective, they were sensitive. And as the time passes by, the color has changed from green to even red in many times. And virtually, and then you now come to a situation where you have very few antibiotics which can be useful in case of the urinary tract infection, particularly the community-acquired infections or instrument-acquired infections. So susceptible organisms are very susceptible organisms to the available drugs are becoming lesser, and almost the significant number of organisms are becoming more and more resistant, and that's why at one or other stage the patients would come to an Ayurvedic physician, and Ayurvedic approach would be one of the better solution to treat with the urinary tract infection many a times. So I would consider this, whether it should be considered as an opportunity or otherwise, that's a issue. But this is the reality. The reality is the resistance would be quite more, and the discharge gives you a very clear idea. And whatever we have, that I have shown you, the data is only up to 2013. In the past 7 years, the situation has changed much, and even for the fourth generation cephalosporins, there is a resistance as such now. So things are changing. And hence, from Ayurvedic point of view, when I treat the patients of urinary tract infections, I would be categorizing those urinary tract infections based upon the dosha lakshanas. And mutra kriksha of the dosha lakshanas, when it's a vataja lakshana, the clinical features would be alpam alpam samutpidya mishkapehanabastvihe paladbhirivakrithena vata ghatena mehadi. When a patient has an increased frequency of micturition and the patient has an urgency of micturition and the patient is not passing a huge quantity of urine every time, it's a small quantity is passed every time. In such conditions, main prescription would be vata-shamaka oshadis and of course the mutrala oshadis and particularly the mutra virechaniya type of the drugs. And main prescription would be Gokshiravika Guru Jirakarkarista or and with Ajamodarka. Jirakarkarista with a small drop of Ajamodarka which can reduce the pain. In case of Pittaga variety, there could be either huge number of RBCs or at times hematuria. Haritra Mustam Raktam Va Mushkabehana Bastikiti. And at the same time, the patient would have high fever and chills like. In that condition, main prescription would be Pitta-shamaka Dravyas like Punarna Mandura, Chandanasava or if the patient has a high fever, at that time Mrityunjaya Rasa also may be prescribed. But usually main prescription would be Punarna Mandura or Chandanasava. If the patient has, it's common for both pediatric as well as adults, females, males. I don't make out that difference from Ayurvedic point of view. If the patient has a Kapada Lakshanas where either there could be a purulent discharge or maybe that the has a very foul smell and not much of a burning sensation and asymptomatic bacteria. Now another of the controversies about the asymptomatic bacteria, whether the asymptomatic bacteria patients need to be treated or not, that's the point. And in such conditions, my prescription would be Chandraprabha Amritarista or occasionally if it's required, like if there is a huge pus like or conditions, you may add Gandhakarasayana along with the same prescription. That's how I used to manage. And important is that the approach to the management would be not related to the organism, but the approach to the management will be based upon the dosha lakshanas. With that, we can manage a good number of patients. But at the same time, we have to be careful about the possible underlying pathologies which may require either a intervention of any sort. So that's the one thing. So only in those conditions where there is no structural pathology, where there is no immediate urgency for a intervention, then we can manage the patients. Of course, the poor prognosis is very typically mentioned in the text, like one is where there is a structural pathology or foreign body like conditions. Mutrabahishu shalyena kshateshu abhyateshu ka or the srotas abhyateshu where there is an abnormality of the mutrabaha srotas or if there is a shalya that's considered, could be considered as asarkya or that the patient would have a high toxic fever or high toxic symptoms like vahashita rujavistaha nana varanam muhum. If the patient has a very high toxic signs, in that condition too, there is a limitation. I don't say that you can manage that patient easily. Or if the patient has a impaired renal function, if it has already resulted in, infection has already resulted in either an acute kidney injury or a chronic renal failure, both of these can be a complication. Acute kidney injury and chronic renal failure we will be discussing separately with other causes too, so we will come to that part later. If there is a gross structural pathology or if the patient's general conditions are poor because of accompanying pathologies like diabetes mellitus, etc., the suggestion of the treatment which I have suggested may not be sufficient. We may need to supplement with the other supportive measures and then of course along with the other supportive measures, this treatment can produce the results. That's in brief about the urinary tract infection and how I manage that.